Hi, I'm Bruce Goldstein. I'm talking about technology transfer, and in this segment I'll be talking about an introduction to copyrights. So some basics about copyright. It applies to what are called original works of authorship. Now, unlike with patents, you really have to be the first to have invented or discovered something. For copyright, it merely means not copied, and you can think about the word itself, copyright. In theory, if I had grown up on an island that was completely isolated from Western civilization, and I managed to write a song that note for note and word for word is the same as the Beatles song Let It Be, I would get my own copyright in that song because I did not copy the original. Now, as a practical matter, of course, if I tried to do that, pretty much no one would believe me, and for good reason. So when people get into fights over it, it's usually based upon, did they have access to it, and how similar is it? The other thing about it, the work that you've created where you're claiming a copyright, it must be fixed in a tangible medium of expression. So the moment you lift your pen from paper, the moment you hit save on the computer and it's recorded in magnetic media, or you expose film, the instant it's fixed, you have a copyright, automatically. You don't have to go to the government and say, give me a copyright. It exists. You own it. There are reasons why that you would want to go and get it registered. But in terms of whether or not you own it, whether it exists, that is automatic. Now, some things cannot be copyrighted. First is raw facts or data. In order for it to be copyrightable, it must actually be a work of authorship. There has to be some sort of creativity. It can be very small amount of creativity, like layout on a page or editorial changes. But the information itself cannot be. So just because I happen to be the first person to say Bruce Goldstein, or my phone number is, and then I cite what my phone number is, I can't copyright my phone number. I can't copyright my name. It's not a work of authorship. Now, mere names, I already mentioned names, titles, slogans, and phrases. The reason I break this one out separately is because most of the time when it's commercially valuable, these things are actually trademarks. So one thing that a lot of people ask is, when they're new to the field of intellectual property, is can I patent a book? Can I trademark a song? Can I, you know, one form of intellectual property is different from the other. You can't overlap them, or they do overlap, but only in very specific circumstances. As a general matter, patents are about function, copyrights are about authorship, trademark is about identifying your product. So you wouldn't copyright something that you're using to identify a product. And as I mentioned, functional aspects, there's a famous case about a bicycle rack that was particularly artistic, but also very efficient as a bicycle rack. Well, you can get the patent to the efficiency of aligning bicycles, and you can get a copyright to the artistic elements in it, but they are protecting different things and in different ways. Finally, works by government employees. This is certainly true in the federal government, and I believe all 50 states as well. Many other countries also follow this rule. If you are a government employee and you are doing work for the government, whatever it is you create, you do not get a copyright in it. Just as a matter of, we don't think this should be freely accessed by everyone. Now, in the United States, at least, employee is strictly defined. So if you are a contractor or a volunteer or a fellow, the rules that apply to you are, what piece of paper did you sign in exchange for your right of access or employment at the government facility? Now, if you own a copyright, it gives you certain specific rights. Now, in this case, those rights are this is not the entire list, but these are the big ones. The first is to duplicate, and that includes taking something and scanning it in, for example, into a different medium. to make what are called derivative works. This is where you tweak somebody's prior version. So edited works, translations, updates, remakes, all these things are considered derivative of the original. Now, most people ask this question too. What about if I change it a lot? Well, there's this gray band of situations where you've changed it. And yeah, sooner or later, if you change it enough, you'll have created your own original work. Where is that line? Well, I don't know. And in the United States, if it actually came down to it, we'd have to ask a jury. Was this just a derivative, or was this so transformative that it became yours? Another right is the right to distribute, even for free. When news organizations were first being put onto the web, there was a feeling like I could take somebody, like the New York Times, I could take their articles and just simply copy them and not pay for the subscription. Or maybe I could charge for a subscription. Turns out, no. Even for free, you can't share somebody else's copyrighted work. That rule is still in effect. And finally, for certain works where it's appropriate, like performances, plays, music, sculpture, the right to perform it or the right to display it publicly is also itself a right. There are other rights as well. Now, with a patent, if you own a patent, you own the patent in a single invention. There's one invention per patent. But in a copyright, it's considered a bundle of straws. Your rights can be subdivided in any way you want. So if you want to have one person here have the rights to your movie to put it in theaters, somebody else has got the book to the musical score, somebody else can release the CD, somebody of the music, somebody else can do TV rights. You can subdivide it however you want, and it's all considered part of the core copyright. So I'd like to give a few clarifications to copyrights. The first is the laws have changed a lot in the recent past, actually over the last like several decades. There are treaties that say if you have a copyright that's valid in your home country, you don't have to register it worldwide, but you still have to check with local counsel to make sure that you understand what the rules are there. And even in the United States, it's changed several times. And what rights you have depends upon when you created it. So definitely don't go by the advice in these slides. However, talk to a copyright attorney. Another major clarification is, and I alluded to this earlier, is that U.S. registration is not required for you to have a valid copyright. If you do register it, you would go to the Library of Congress, not the Patent and Trademark Office, a little quirk of U.S. law. There are good reasons for registering your copyright. First and foremost, if you don't register it, you will not be able to go into court and sue. Now, you can register it after the fact. You can wait until there's actually a reason to do it and then go and get your registration. But you won't be able to initiate the lawsuit without that certificate. The other thing is the sooner you register it, the easier it is to collect damages should you catch somebody infringing your copyright. If the infringement happens before you register, you actually have to prove the economic harm. If you first register and then you find out of infringement, you don't have to prove harm. You can simply say, judge, make them write a check. And the judge will do that. And finally, formal notice is not required. You'll see that C in a circle, 2007, Bruce Goldstein. That would be an example of how you would put formal notice onto a work, but you're not required to. But as I was saying, in order to get damages, you have to prove that they copied, and it's much easier to prove that they copied if you've got a warning on it saying this is copyrighted. Finally, as I mentioned, the term of the copyright equals the life of the author plus 70 years. So as I alluded to in another segment, there are good reasons why it's that long. The copyright only covers a very narrow thing, the act of copying. And so if you really need to copy somebody else's work, you're probably better off finding another way to do it. That's why we give, and the other thing is starving artists often take a good bit more than 20 years before they can finally get the recognition and the market acceptance of their works. So this is considered fair. And Congress in the United States can shorten or lengthen that time at any time. So enforcing a copyright, as I already mentioned, filing a suit requires registration. But the thing is, registration is pretty simple. Basically, you fill in a form and send in a check with a sample or a picture or some evidence of what it is you're registering. The Copyright Office doesn't go out and see, were you the first to write this work? They don't care. They're just registering it. That's a big contrast from patents, where the Patent Office will go out and see, are you in fact the first to invent something? So getting it is very simple. But it's also pretty weak, because you're still going to have to prove, potentially, I didn't copy my work. My work is truly copyrightable, that your copyright is valid. If you are accused of copying, there are a few specific defenses. The biggest one is compulsory licensing. Now, unlike patents, there are no compulsory licenses for patents, or actually there are some, but they're esoteric. For copyrights, though, you can do a cover of anyone's song. You can't stop people. So people who think, oh, my heavy metal band sold out to Muzak and other elevator music companies, no, they really couldn't stop it. Now, to say that, these elevator music companies don't get a free ride. They have to pay for it. And so there are ASCAP, CCC, and I've forgotten the third one, but basically these are clearing houses where they go to the artist and say, if you assign us your copyright, we'll take care of the licensing and do packages to various companies that want to have music on in the background or to other artists. And then we will give you a check every 6 months or a year representing how much we collected for your work. For software, you have a statutory right to make a copy into RAM, into backup, into archive. Now, for archive in particular, backup and archive, you're only allowed to make one of those. And if you think about a tax prep software, you buy it, you do your taxes, you're done, and now your brother-in-law wants to do it. You can, in fact, sell that particular You can transfer that particular copy. But in that case, you're going to have to delete the ones that you made for yourself. So you can transfer it that way. The other major defense is fair use. So in copyright law, it's a pretty harsh doctrine if you apply it strictly. Any copy is an infringement. But there's also a certain area where either we don't want to allow the copyright owners to be overly harsh, because that kind of copying in that particular context actually benefits society. So things like criticism, commenting, news reporting, teaching, scholarship, research, or parody, and this is not an exclusive list. It's any socially good thing, a reason why we want to encourage a certain measure of copying. But it's not a free pass. So, yeah, I can make photocopies of somebody's artwork for purposes of a class, but that doesn't mean somebody can turn around and take what I've created, what I've used, and sell it. And I can't go around and selling somebody else's work, even if I used it as part of a class. It's also not a matter of what I think is fair, or what the copyright owner thinks is fair. Fair is determined by a jury. So you're rolling the dice, and if you're using the fair use defense, you've already pretty much admitted your hand was elbow deep in the cookie jar. So you're already in an uphill battle to convince the jury that, yeah, give me a pass. So it's highly risky. The fact is, if you really do have a fair use and you're worried about it, I've found that if you put in a call, send an email to whoever it is who owns the copyright and say, look, this is what I plan to do, overwhelmingly they're going to say, yeah, fine, go ahead and do it. If they say, absolutely not, well, maybe your use is fair, but do you really need to use that particular piece of copyrighted work? Chances are no. Chances are you can create something new or you can find another source that does it equivalently. Since I work at the NIH and many of the people I work with work in government, I do want to at least pass along a few tidbits for what you need to worry about as a government person. First is in procurement. And this is a principle that is true anywhere, but for us in particular, it's important that you know what it is. When you sign a procurement contract, they're going to write something, make something copyrightable. Make sure you know what it is you need from that contract. If you need a piece of work that you can turn around and distribute, you might want to make sure that the deliverable in your contract actually says that you have that right. Otherwise, they're going to hand you a copy and you're stuck. You can't do anything with it because they still own the copyright and they can stop you from distributing it. It's important to know when you're doing these contracts that the normal rule is the author owns the copyright. So maybe you need them to assign you the copyright altogether. Maybe you don't. Maybe you want to tell them, no, for this particular work, there should be no copyright. Whatever it is, you need to know these things up front. And while we can make a contractor assign copyright to the government, Congress unfortunately didn't give us the right to keep royalties. So we can only license it non-exclusively royalty-free. And there are a few instances when exactly we need to do precisely that. But you need to know these things up front. Also, it's important to know that for both patents and copyrights, we can infringe it. We can willfully thumb our nose at these things, but we can't do it freely. They can come and demand what's called a reasonable royalty and make the agency pay for what we would have paid had we actually negotiated a license up front. And again, it's not what we think is fair or what the other side thinks is fair. It's what we can convince a jury is fair. But we can do it and thumb our nose at it, and they, the copyright owner or the patent owner, can't stop us by getting what's called an injunction. So thank you for your attention. I hope you found it useful. And if you have any questions, please direct them to the program coordinator.